Hello and welcome to Newsmax TV. I'm John Bachman. Back with us again is former UN Ambassador John Bolton. As always, Ambassador Bolton, it's great to talk to you.
Well, thanks again for having me. Glad to be with you.
All right, so we're still looking at these terror warnings at U.S. embassies across the Middle East and Africa. Intelligence officials apparently intercepted some communication between al-Qaeda's boss, Ayman al-Zawahiri, and a deputy in Yemen. Some security analysts say this type of communication is a big break from al-Qaeda procedure. Is that how you see it? And if so, what does this say about the state of al-Qaeda's leadership right now?
Well, I was very surprised when I heard reference and it leaks from the Obama administration about this specific telephone call, because I think it would be very unusual for Zawahiri to break communications security and be caught this way. But if in fact it did happen, obviously it's not helpful to the United States for the administration to leak about it, so that now if Zawahiri had any doubts, he knows that we have heard what he said. I think so. I think just in general, this is another case of the administration leaking information, which it thinks helps the administration, but which in fact is very dangerous. I do think that if that is an accurate description of what we heard, though, it's ironically a refutation of the Obama administration's whole storyline on al-Qaeda being on the road to defeat, al-Qaeda in Afghanistan and Pakistan being a tiny sliver of what it used to be and really not responsible for operations worldwide, because that intercept proves exactly the opposite.
Yeah, I have a question for you that I wanted to ask about the way the White House differentiates between al-Qaeda and its syndicates. I'll get to that in just a couple minutes. But following up on what I just asked you, you know, is it possible that at least part of the objective here by al-Qaeda's leaders may have been realized? You know, the world's seen this massive response. Al-Qaeda, the terrorists, know that they have the power to shutter these embassies in the world just simply based on online or phone chatter. You know, if this wasn't the intended outcome, they have to at least, you know, take some sort of moral victory away from this, right?
Well, you know, you can always speculate about whether this was real or not. Presumably, the evaluation that the intelligence analyst gave to it was whether it was a ruse or whether it was real. Sitting where I am, I certainly can't second-guess their conclusion that it was real. And I think, honestly, since we're not playing checkers here, if people thought it was a real threat, we really didn't have any option in the immediate, in the present, to do anything other than announce the closures. I do think it raises the larger and obviously more important question about the effect of the weakening of the U.S. position against the terrorist threat that the Obama administration has brought about by not recognizing that we're in a global war on terror, trying to treat it as a law enforcement matter, and basically trying to argue that the war was basically over.
Yeah, I'm not really questioning whether or not this was real or not. I agree it's not really our place to do that here, but the fact that they did have such a, you know, it did have such an impact, even the threat here, you know, this tells us a lot about, you know, where we are in the world and where we are in this fight against al-Qaeda, correct?
Yeah, well, it tells us that we're in a much weaker position, and I think that's attributable at the macro level to the incorrectness of Obama's worldview, that terrorism really isn't that much of a threat, that you can treat it not as a war against us, which I think it is, but as random, occasional, localized acts of violence. You know, ironically, just at the time we're looking at these events in Yemen and elsewhere in the Middle East, Major Nidal Hassan is on trial for the Fort Hood shootings, which the administration described as workplace violence and a lone wolf, not really part of the international terrorist threat. I think that's also part of the unwillingness to see that the terrorists really do constitute a threat, that they are still at war with us. Whether we want to be at war or not, it's unfortunately not our call. They're the ones who attacked us on 9/11, and the threat continues.
Yeah, unfortunately, so much of this does seem to be on their terms, as you mentioned. Obviously, the Obama administration and the Pentagon and Langley would like to take out al-Zawahiri here, but you know, we've seen how drones have been utilized against al-Qaeda leadership, especially in Yemen. But even if the administration or the Defense Department knew where Zawahiri was, is he too valuable for a drone strike? Is it more important, I guess critically important, to capture him?
Well, I think capturing more of these al-Qaeda leaders, taking them to Guantanamo Bay, and being prepared to to use enhanced interrogation techniques if that seems appropriate. It makes a lot more sense than just trying to close Gitmo down, trying the people that we capture in civilian trials in United States district courts and the like, which is what the Obama administration's strategy has been. I mean, there's a disconnect. The idea that they would use drones without any due process at all while we're on the subject to kill people who are al-Qaeda terrorists, but not be willing to question them in Gitmo is a contradiction I've never understood in the Obama administration's own policy.
Well, let's move on to Iran if we can for a second. Actually, I want to do a follow-up with that question we talked about briefly a few moments ago, and that's how the White House continues to differentiate between al-Qaeda's central leadership, al-Zawahiri and the like, and that of its syndicates like al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. Are they splitting hairs here? I guess you kind of answered that question, yes. And, you know, is it important to differentiate as the White House seems to be doing?
Well, I think the White House is trying to narrow what real al-Qaeda is down to a tiny fragment of itself so that that aids their narrative that the war on terror is over. But it's a mistake to think that al-Qaeda was ever organized like a corporation or a military hierarchy. In its history, it has central control from the al-Qaeda core over its affiliates has ebbed and flowed as circumstances warranted. And indeed, it's been one of the strengths of al-Qaeda, I think, that it has given al-Qaeda in Iraq, al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, al-Qaeda in the Maghreb in North Africa, given these affiliates or branches or whatever you want to call them, a lot of discretion and independence, because it means that al-Qaeda continues even when, for example, we kill Osama bin Laden. So trying to imagine that you can redefine al-Qaeda to suit your purposes, I think, was always a mistake. And even to the extent it might have had some degree of accuracy at some point, I think the present circumstance shows that al-Qaeda is a very adaptive organization, sadly, and it represents a threat that doesn't go away just because we hope it will.
Yeah, they clearly seem to be at least a couple steps ahead in certain situations like this one involving the embassies. Let's do move on to Iran. I know time's short. We want to talk about this as well. This past weekend, the new president, Hassan Rouhani, was sworn in. He's promising to be less antagonistic to the West. And some say he may even wish to engage with the U.S. in direct talks on Iran's nuclear program. But what does Rouhani and Iran have to do first to prove that it's worth any U.S. official's time to actually sit down and listen to the Iranians?
Well, I think all of this is part of a charm offensive that's designed to lull the United States and Europe into more negotiations over the nuclear weapons program, which I think is simply intended in turn to buy Iran more time to get closer to its 20-year-plus objective of getting deliverable nuclear weapons. And Rouhani has been through this strategy before, 10 years ago when he was the chief nuclear negotiator. It worked for Iran then. He thinks it will work for them again now. I call it the P.T. Barnum doctrine, meaning there's a sucker born every minute, and Iran is counting on us to fill that role again.
So nothing new here with Rouhani. There's nothing to this, and we should just reject any of their overtures to be more friendly.
Well, I think we should reject our overtures, but I don't think we will. I think the Obama administration's determined to negotiate. Rouhani is a moderate in the sense he's smarter than Ahmadinejad in talking about the nuclear weapons program. Ahmadinejad liked to put it in our face, and Rouhani knows that Iran and the nuclear weapons program are a lot better off if they're put into the background.
Yeah, sometimes smarter can also mean more dangerous as well. Let's move on to Egypt real quickly as well. Senators John McCain and Lindsey Graham have arrived to help steer talks between Mohamed Morsi supporters, Islamists, the Muslim Brotherhood, and the military. The Egyptian military and the officials of the new interim government. What are some specific things that McCain and Graham, along with Deputy Secretary of State William Burns, need to get established to prove that this process is moving in the right direction?
Well, I think the Muslim Brotherhood itself is an anti-democratic institution. As Justice Jackson once described the Communist Party in this country, the Brotherhood is like a state within a state. And Therefore, whether it should even be permitted to participate as if it were really, in the Egyptian context, no different than the Republican or Democratic parties in the United States is very much open to question. I think there are a lot of people in Egypt who say, look, if we end up scheduling elections in 6, 9, even 12 months, we're just going to be repeating the mistake we made 2 years ago, because the Brotherhood is the best organized political force in Egypt. It will win the elections again, and it will once again begin mounting the kind of creeping coup toward a Sharia-based state that Morsi was on the way to creating. I think we need to have a serious conversation, not about whether people of deep religious views can participate in Egyptian politics. Of course, they should be able to. But whether an organization like the Brotherhood is suitable for participating in a real democratic society. And I think that is very doubtful.
Okay, Egypt, of course, as we know, very important in what takes place there. Also, these negotiations are taking place at the same time. In terms of the Mideast peace process, there seems to be at least the tiniest little bit of optimism that a new pathway forward to peace in the Middle East can be worked out between Israel and members of the Palestinian leadership. But still, I would say it's fair to say there's way more pessimism about this entire process. With so many people predicting another failure on this front, and with so many of the other issues demanding Secretary of State John Kerry's time and attention, are these new Mideast peace talks essentially a waste of time?
Well, put me down on the pessimistic side. I think they are, because the fundamental differences between Israel and the Palestinians have not changed in the last 6 months or a year. And indeed, I would argue that there is a potential downside for the United States, having gotten these talks started, if they fail, as I fear inevitably they will do, because we will have devoted a lot of time and energy and obviously a lot of American prestige to having the talks go forward. And if they fail, that will be seen as a failure of America's strength in the region, and I think it will have adverse consequences for us, unfortunately.
Some people have even gone as far to say that this is basically John Kerry putting his career on the line. We'll see what happens there. Ambassador John Bolton, always a pleasure to talk with you. Thanks for being with us.
Well, thanks again for having me.
And thank you for watching Newsmax TV.